I'm making this video because the previous one on this topic is now quite old and showed radio management version 1. For starters, you will need to download radio management from your chosen source. Please don't ask me to share this software. It's simply not allowed. There is a link in the description to a blog post on how to legally get this software. It's a big file, so be patient. Once you've downloaded the file, you will need to unzip it. Before installing, make sure Windows is up to date and that you have administrator rights on the computer and hard drive. Once unzipped, you should run setup.exe as an administrator. Then, select your language and which packages you want to install. Since I'm setting up the server, I'm going to select everything. This also installs RM Client, which allows me to log into the database locally. In this case, I don't want RM to automatically add radio. You can select this option, then turn it off or on again later. Accept the license terms, click Next, and finish your coffee. For new installs, you don't need to worry about the migration analysis. This is only needed to check if you have an existing database with old templates in it. There is a link in the description to a blog post on this aspect of radio management. The folder locations should be left as default. If you see this script running, it's usually a good sign that there aren't any errors. Running setup.exe as an administrator isn't necessary, but I found that it eliminates any potential problems with permissions later in the installation process. Ticking Auto Update Enable allows the radio management server to act as a download point for older clients. I'll go into this a little at the end of the video. A reboot will be needed, after which the installation completes. Initial setup. Once you've installed the software, there are some other things needed in order for the software to allow someone to log in remotely, to support IP programming of repeaters, and device programmer hosts. The first task is to create a backup of the blank database. This is useful if you ever need to wipe everything. You don't have to do it though. Next, I will create some user logins. You can optionally allow the user to keep the same password, or you can force them to change it on the first login. Don't forget to tick RM Client User. Once you're done, click Save. Next, we need to configure Windows Defender Firewall to pass radio management traffic. TCP port 443 is needed to allow the radio management client to log into the server. The other ports need to be opened to allow IP traffic between the local device programmer and repeaters, as well as between the job processor and remote device programmers. Port numbers which are used by RM are listed in the server utility under network settings. You really need to pay attention to this, as it's a common problem with new installations. When setting up the firewall rules, you need to select on what type of network this rule should be active on. This also needs to be considered, as opening ports without due consideration could be a security risk. Each firewall rule needs a name. I just call mine Radio Management or MOTOTRBO. Remember that you need an inbound and an outbound rule. Next, we should confirm that all device programmers are able to connect to the server. You you should also set up the communications method here too. All of these settings are covered in my radio management workshop videos. We can also check the connectivity between the job processor and server. You can also set the number of concurrent jobs here. The number of concurrent jobs is dependent on how many device programmers you have connected, how many radios you want to OTAP at the same time, and how many processor cores you can spare for this task. Now we can log in. I'm not using DNS yet, so I have to enter the IP address of the server. Once logged in, you can start using radio management. Things. One thing you might want to do is to import radio firmware. To do this, first install the firmware package on the PC. Now you can import the firmware into radio management. But be careful. Radio management looks for firmware on the local machine. That is, if you are connected remotely, RM will only list the firmware that is on your PC, not the server. You can import whatever is local on your machine, but it will upload all of those files to the server, which can take some time. To import firmware into RM, I prefer to install the firmware as well as connect locally on the server. That way, the firmware import goes a lot more quickly. To keep your database file size small, it's a good idea to only import the firmware you will actually use. Importing lots of firmware increases the database size. Here, I'm going locally and importing the firmware there. If you're going to OTAP radios via the repeater using an AI or via a Capacity Max data gateway, you'll need to install MNIS. There's a link in the description to some blog posts discussing what MNIS does. Also, if you're going to OTAP radios, either via control station or using MNIS, you'll most certainly need DDMS. There's a link in the description to some posts discussing what a DDMS does. Note that you don't need DDMS for a Capacity Max deployment. MNIS and DDMS are not required in order for radio management to work. They are only needed if you will use OTAP. Things you might encounter. If you have an older version of RM client on your PC, you may be prompted to upgrade when logging in. If auto update was enabled during setup, You can upgrade by clicking Yes. Depending on your network speed, this can take some time since the installer downloads to your local PC. To avoid this, I prefer to distribute the RM client installer on a USB stick, or at least put it somewhere where it can be downloaded faster. The RM Client Installer can be found in the RMC folder. Just copy the MSI file onto a stick and go around to the computers and install it there, if feasible, of course. Now, to use Radio Management, I invite you to have a look at my Radio Management Workshop videos, as well as the videos dealing with Multi-Site Capacity Plus. All of them can be found on my YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.